Good morning, friends. So hope you had a good night's of sleep, and hopefully in your dreams you saw some visualization of motion. So what we did yesterday was we introduced to you the concepts of concepts and terminologies that we will frequently encounter in our study of particle kinematics. Let me have a quick recap of what were the important concepts which was carried through in yesterday's lectures. Firstly, we had a discussion of what is meant by particle and what is meant by rigid body. So particle concept and rigid body concept are two very important concepts, and hopefully through yesterday's lectures you should be able to assimilate the distinction between these two very important concepts, that of a particle and that of rigid body. Just to repeat the result, particle was a kind of an object such that all points in the object would have the same displacement, velocity and acceleration, whereas that is necessarily not true for a rigid body. And the second most important concept was that of rectilinear motion . So again, to repeat myself, rectilinear motion is that kind of motion which can be described in a single variable. Position, velocity, acceleration for all times during the analysis will be represented in terms of a single variable and nothing else. We also qualified what is planar motion, that which to locate in Cartesian coordinates you would require two coordinates. Two or three variables would be required in Cartesian coordinates. But we could solve this same problem using curvilinear coordinates, wherein one variable would be sufficient. So that was just the theoretical treatment of particle kinematics without really going into the formal theory and derivations and whatnot. So the agenda for the day is to go to the formal theory of each of these, firstly rectilinear motion and secondly planar motion, at least in Cartesian coordinates. So planar motion in Cartesian coordinates will include, for example, projectile motion, which is a very important topic in your curriculum, I guess. So before I proceed with today's content, so yesterday we did look at the representation in terms of position. So we talked about piecewise representation, in which you had a function relationship between the position and time, but that function relationship was not possible for a single function relationship was not possible across the entire time of interest. So you had to break it down into a number of parts, as we talked yesterday. So today we will move ahead from the positional aspects to the velocity and the acceleration aspects. So let's make a beginning. So as per our convention, at time t, we say that the displacement of the particle is x of t. That's our notation. So therefore, after an infinitesimal time delta t has elapsed beyond t, then the displacement of the particle would be x of t plus delta t. Remember, x is a function of time. So at every time, the position or displacement would be in terms of a function. So therefore, at a later time t plus delta t, the displacement is expected to be x at t plus delta t. So therefore, change in displacement is this minus this, which is x of t plus delta t minus x of t. And finally, velocity, which is defined to be the rate of change of displacement, is limit as this delta t, this infinitesimal time, goes to 0. Delta x by delta t, which by definition of calculus is coming out to be the differentiation or the derivative of x with respect to time. So the derivative of x with respect to time is basically velocity. So velocity is the derivative of displacement function, and geometrically, if you plot out the displacement, as I did encourage you to do so yesterday, the slope of that displacement time plot would indicate the velocity. So we'll see a few examples today as we go along. So velocity is itself a function of time, and therefore, just like position, it could have two different ways of representation. Either you could represent it in terms of a formula or a mathematical expression, or you could express it in terms of a graphical plot. And we'll look at both these representations for similar kind of problems. So here is the first example. So if you remember, we had this first example where the position was given as 5 times the time, x of t was plotted as displacement against time, and the functional relationship was 5 times t. So this is the plot of displacement against time. So if you now plot velocity, the functional dependence of velocity with time is simply the derivative of 5t with respect to t, which means that it should be 5. So all across this time, the velocity is stay put at a constant value of 5. The displacement increases linearly implies the velocity is constant. So as we just said, that the velocity is nothing but the slope of the displacement time graph. Since this graph is looking like a constant, is a straight line, is a linear in its variation, and therefore you find that the slope of it is constant, and the slope of this displacement against time plot is basically what is plotted here as velocity. For the second example, we had a non-uniform rectilinear motion, which was as shown in this kind of a plot. The displacement versus time plot that was shown to you in the last slide yesterday was something like this. So we will, the functional relationship was in this form. So we'll look back at that example and try and derive displacement, try and derive the velocity in this condition. So the functional relationship, if you recall, is given by this formula, where there were 4 different functional expressions which were used at 4 different time intervals. So now what we have to do in order to find the derivative is we have to individually take differentiation of each of these functions, and the derivative of each of these individual pieces will correspond to the velocity at each of these time intervals. For example, in the first segment we had the position given by 5 times t, and the derivative of this function is simply 5, which is from t equals to 0 to 100. That's the first interval of time. Then x of t in the next segment of time was given as 1000 minus 5t. The derivative in this case will turn out to be minus 5, and this velocity is applicable in the interval of 100 to 200. In the third segment, the velocity was, the position was not changing, it was 0. So therefore, the velocity also turns out to be 0. In the last segment, it is, the position is 60 times t minus 250. So the derivative of this will be 60. This is a typographical error that I have on my slide. Please make a change of it. Instead of 10, it should read as 60. I will myself revise the slides that I have been uploaded in the course pack for all the typographical errors that I have come to my notice. But obviously, the velocity is the derivative of x of t, and in this case, the derivative of x of t should be 60 rather than 10 as it reads. So just like for the displacement plot, you had a piecewise functional representation in individual segments of time intervals. Similarly, the velocity, which is nothing but the slope of the displacement curve, is going to have a representation which will vary between these different time segments. So the first segment, it will read as plus 5. In the second segment, it will read as minus 5. In the third segment, it will read as 0. And finally, in the fourth segment, it will read as 10. So if I now happen to plot this function, you will recall that this is the displacement plot that we had for the displacement function. This is the displacement function. Again, another typographical error. This legend should read as 60 into t minus 250 rather than 60 into x minus 250, because the function is 60 into t minus 250. We are plotting x, and the x function in this last segment between 250 to 300 is 60 into t minus 250. So if you are having a printout or something, please make this change. I will myself edit the uploaded file in due course. But if this be the displacement plot, what we are now looking to plot is the velocity. So the velocity plot, as the functional relationship looks like this. In the first segment, it will be 5. In the second segment, it will be minus 5, as we have derived In the third segment, it is 0 as we have derived here, and in the final segment, it will be 60. I think we have taken it as 10, that this value should be 60. This should not be 10, this should rather be 60 if this functional relationship is to be correct. However, if this formula is to be correct, then it has to be 10. But none the same, you get this point that the slope of this curve, if the displacement plot is given to us, we observe that this displacement plot is a collection of straight lines in this form, and the velocity is going to be the slope of this curve. So the velocity being the slope of this curve, the first part will have positive slope, which is what is indicated here. The exact value of the slope also could be calculated by noting what is the base and what is this height. So if you do that slope calculation, it will turn out again that it is plus 5. Please note that in the second segment, it is clear from the displacement plot the slope is negative, as opposed to the first segment wherein it is clear that the slope is positive. Here it is very clear that the slope is negative, and in fact it is so from the analytical calculations, and that is why you get a value of minus 5. In the third segment, you have a straight line, but this straight line is actually dead constant. So therefore, this straight line is having 0 slope, and that indicates the velocity within this period 200 to 250 is actually going to be 0. And lastly, in this last segment, supposedly to be 60 into t minus 250, it would have a slope of 60 if the 60 were to be true. But since we had this typographical here, we plotted it as 10, which is erroneous. We will correct this. But hopefully you get that idea that this is how we have a graphical representation of velocity given either the graphical representation of displacement or the functional representation of displacement. So carrying this analogy further, we go forward towards acceleration. The relationship between velocity to displacement is just the same as the relationship between acceleration to velocity, as we will quickly go through. So again, we say at time t, the velocity of the particle, this is another typographical error, this is not x of t, this is v of t. Therefore, at after an infinitesimal time delta t, the velocity of the particle is v of t plus delta t. Again, to recall, at time t, velocity of the particle is v of t, x of t is a typographical error, it should read as v of t. After an infinitesimal time, delta t has elapsed, the velocity of the particle is v of t plus delta t. So therefore, the change in velocity within the infinitesimal time period delta t is v of t plus delta t minus v of t. And therefore, acceleration, which is defined to be the rate of change of velocity, will turn out to be the limit of delta v by delta t, as delta t is taken to be small. And by definition of calculus, this ratio is nothing but the derivative of v with respect to t. So therefore, if you are given the position with time functional relationship, the derivative, first derivative of it is a velocity to time relationship. The velocity to time relationship is itself a function, and that function, if you again take derivative, you will land up with the acceleration. And acceleration mathematically is the derivative of the velocity function, just like the velocity was the derivative of the position function. And the geometrical interpretation is also very analogous, that is, geometrically the acceleration would be the slope of the velocity time plot, just like velocity was the slope of the position time plot, because we know the derivative is interpreted to be the slope of the plot as is the case. So therefore, acceleration would be the slope of the velocity time plot, just like velocity was the slope of the displacement time plot. So we will see the acceleration. So again, like velocity and like position, acceleration can also be expressed either as a functional relationship of time, or it can be related in a graphical form. And we will do that for a more complicated problem. But before we do that, let us see for the same piecewise representation that we have, or maybe we can go one slide backwards also. So if this is the displacement against time, we had already plotted if this is the displacement against time for uniform rectilinear motion, and by uniform rectilinear motion, I mean rectilinear motion whose velocity is constant. So this displacement being a linear function of time clearly indicated that the velocity is going to be the constant. But now if velocity is constant, that means the acceleration plot is dead zero, which is why I have not taken the pain of actually plotting. Because if velocity is dead zero as is being shown here, then acceleration is velocity is 5, which is a constant over time, then the acceleration, which is the derivative of this velocity, is going to be 0. So therefore, not a big deal to plot. There is nothing to plot, in fact, which is why I have left it out. Now coming to this piecewise representation, in the piecewise representation, if this was the displacement plot, we have already described in some details, the velocity plot would look like this. So in this time between 0 to 100, we again observe that velocity is constant. So again within this time interval, we see that the acceleration is constant. Again, between the time interval 100 to 200, we see that the velocity is minus 5 and therefore the acceleration is dead zero within this time interval. Same is true for the last interval. But note, there is something different that is happening exactly at the point 100 and 200. At the point 100 and 200, velocity is changing by a finite value within an infinitesimal time. So here you observe that the velocity has drastically changed. Just before 100, it was 5, and just after 100 seconds, it is minus 5, which means there has been a finite change in velocity within an infinitesimal time. That is to say that in terms of the formula, you have delta t going towards 0, but you have delta v remaining finite, which means acceleration will actually turn infinite. So if you have this kind of a velocity plot, one can argue that the acceleration at precisely these points wherein the velocity jumps by a finite value abruptly without any elapse of time, that's going to be infinite. That is dictated by the mathematics of the problem. Obviously, in reality, this is disallowed because it is not possible that the velocity abruptly jumps from plus 5 to minus 5 without any lapse of time. There will be a small interval delta t where it will smoothly change from plus 5 to minus 5. That's possibly something which was not considered at this stage. So it is not possible that this sort of a kinematics is actually shown by any real engineering application, simply because these abrupt jumps are not possible. They will induce large acceleration. Okay, but coming to a more non-intuitive example, you have possibly encountered simple harmonic motion in your high school physics. So in simple harmonic motion, the position against time relationship is known to be of this form. A is the amplitude of the simple harmonic motion. Since it's simple harmonic motion, it is expressed as a sine or a cosine. And this omega is called the angular frequency of the simple harmonic motion, and phi is called the phase. So if you put any value of A and phi, whatever numerical value you want to put, you can put. Similarly, omega, you can choose whatever real positive numerical value you want. And then the differentiation of this expression with respect to time is going to be the velocity. So it is easy to see the derivative of x of t, where x as a function of t is precisely given by this expression, will lead to A times omega times cos omega t plus phi. You know, sine of x when differentiated with x leads to cos x. So sine of omega t plus phi when differentiated with respect to t will lead to cos of omega t plus phi multiplied by an omega sitting outside here. So therefore, this is the expression for the simple harmonic motion velocity. And similarly, now since this is a nice looking expression, I can again derive the derivative of this function. So velocity as a function of time, if it is this, it is easy to see that the derivative of this expression with respect to time would lead to a minus sign. And since there is an omega multiplying the t, that omega will come out and you will get an omega square. So therefore, the acceleration, the functional relationship of acceleration with time is the following. We have minus a omega square sine omega t plus phi. But please note that a sine omega t plus phi is x of t. So therefore, the acceleration of t is, if I take omega square common, then acceleration of t is minus omega square x of t. Again, this last bracket is unnecessarily, so it can simply read as acceleration of t as minus omega square x of t. So therefore, what we have shown you is that if the positional dependence, if the functional dependence of position is given to you, you can easily derive through a routine process of differentiation the velocity and acceleration plot. So this is what we call the functional dependence or the mathematical or the analytical dependence of the kinematics with time. You have position, you have velocity, you have acceleration as a function of time in terms of a formula. But probably as engineers, what is more informative is that how would this plot look like. So we go ahead and put some values of a and omega and actually make this plot. So this is the plot of displacement, velocity and acceleration as has been derived here. So here we had chosen a equals to 2 and we have chosen omega to be probably about little more than pi, I think, right? So we have chosen appropriately omega and a and phi also. Phi is 0 in this case, and we have made this plot. So the crucial point is this: if the displacement plot looks like a sine wave, velocity looks like a cos, but the acceleration again looks exactly the mirror image of the displacement plot. So therefore, it is not sufficient to just look at the formula. Please plot it with appropriate numerical values of a and omega, and when you do that, you will get to see more information. How is this information more than what is contained here? With this graph, you can actually find out what is the exact value of displacement at any time. You could have also found it out through this formula by putting the in your calculator the value of t, you will get what is x. At that appropriate t, if you plug in this value of t, you will get the v. If you put in the value of t, you will get the value of acceleration. So therefore, the displacement, velocity and acceleration plots can be derived once these functional relationships are available with you. And as I said yesterday, that you should in this generation of engineering curriculum, you should immediately in your first year itself, you should start making these plots yourself, either in a scientific computational software such as MATLAB or even in a very standard routine software such as MS Excel. So please practice plotting graphs out given these functional relationships. So till now we were dealing with rectilinear motion. So one non-intuitive exercise and one I would say at a higher level of difficulty, I have posed a problem that of a cam follower mechanism. Probably you will encounter cam follower mechanism in details when you study kinematics of mechanisms. Therein you will do a lot of advanced analysis based on this cam followers. Just to give you an idea what a cam follower is, you would have seen the such cam followers in the action of let's say engines, and the valves of the engines are usually operated using cam followers. Any engine will have valves, and if these valves are mechanically operated, then possibly it is due to the action of a mechanical cam which is rotating. These days, obviously, some more sophisticated engines will have electronically operated valves. But let's say we have traditional engines where the valves were operated by a cam. So let's not get into too much of the details of how a cam works and things like that. But what we have here is an elliptic disc. So this disc, we are quite comfortable with the idea of a circular disc. This elliptic disc is of geometry such that the major axis is 2a and the minor axis is 2b. Now the point is this elliptic disc is rotating in a counterclockwise fashion as indicated in this figure, and on this point there is a very sharp knife edge which is resting. So you can understand as this elliptic disc is rotating, this knife edge is going to reciprocate, because this knife edge is forced to be within this guide, and as a result the knife edge will move up and down. The question that I asked to you is that what is the motion of the follower if I know that the cam is rotating at a constant angular speed of omega. Okay, so by motion what I mean is that find the position, velocity and acceleration and draw them as a function of time and thereby analyze this kind of motion. So you will do such detailed kinematic analysis definitely when you do a course on kinematic analysis, but I don't think it is too far-fetched at this point to solve this problem. I'll give you a minute to think and also a minute to ask me if you need help towards the solution of this problem. So it will be nice if you can start working out this problem. Please note that the knife edge is having rectilinear motion because this knife edge is going to have just up and down motion. It is constrained to move within the guide. There is no way it will rock or have any other motion. It is only possible that it will move up and down. So that should give you an important hint as to how to go about solving this motion. My suggestion to you is please think from first principles. The first principles require that you firstly define a coordinate system as is appropriate for this problem and then try to find x as a function of time. So let's say I'll give you one more hint to start with. Let's say I define a coordinate system with origin right at the center of this elliptic cam. And from here, I wish to determine the position of this knife edge. So x for me will be from this point to that point. X is the position of the knife edge as measured from the origin. You could choose another coordinate system also, but that will simply complicate the problem. Yeah, I see some questions posted to me. We would like, okay, so TPCA is asking me what is the difference between displacement and distance and speed and velocity. Speed is just the magnitude of velocity. Distance is the magnitude of displacement. Displacement is a vectorial quantity. Velocity is a vectorial quantity, whereas distance and speed are scalar quantities. So the magnitude of displacement is going to be distance and the magnitude of velocity is going to be speed. In rectilinear motion, despite doing problems in one variable, we will account for the fact that the motion of, let's say, this knife edge could either be in the positive direction or be in the negative direction. So the x or the v values could be positive or negative. So therefore, the v that we are trying to determine out of the differentiation process is velocity, not speed. So obviously, I think velocity makes more sense rather than speed because speed is simply the magnitude. If you have a velocity of minus 5, its speed is 5. If the velocity is plus 5, the speed is also plus 5. I hope this clarifies the answer for TPCA, the question for TPCA. TPCA, please leave a comment if you think your answer has been clarified. BACR is asking me, what is the effect of constraint force on a body? Well, I think this is about the content of yesterday's lecture, but I will repeat it for your clarification. When you have a static force, a force which is not changing with time on a constrained body, I think what you asked me is that what is the effect of force on a constrained body rather than effect of a constrained force on a body. So, I will frame it that way. BSR has asked me what is the effect of force on a constrained body. If the force is static force, the force which is not changing with time, that force will tend to cause static deflection and stresses and strains on the body. I hope that answers the question. But at this point, let us try to solve this question on cam follower mechanism. Can we limit ourselves to the discussion? We will come back to interactions regarding some other fundamental questions at an appropriate time, but to keep the flow of the lecture going, I will appreciate if you can ask me questions which should possibly help you solve this cam follower mechanism problem. What is the difference between displacement and distance moved? I think this, as I was asking, KSRCT is asking what is the difference between displacement and distance moved. I think the essential difference is that of magnitude. Displacement is a vector, distance is the magnitude of the displacement vector. That's all. So, if you want to take displacement, you have to take the sign for it. When you want to take distance, you have to take only the positive part of it. Okay. So, let me illustrate this because this question is being posted by a number of people. So let's say the body starts from here at t equals to 0. This is the initial point from where the body starts, and I have put my origin exactly at this point. At let's say t equals to 1, it has come here. So therefore the distance is, let's say here x is equals to 1, right? So here both the displacement and distance has the same value. Both displacement and distance is equal to 1. But let's say at time t equals to 2 seconds, the body has come here, x equals to minus 1. So now if I wish to cover to understand what is the distance covered by the body between time t equals to 0 to time t equals to 2. So distance covered from t equals to 0 to t equals to 2 would be 1. You don't need to put a minus 1 because this is the distance covered. Distance covered from t equals to 0 to t equals to 2. But if I say what is the displacement from the origin of this point at t equals to 2, I should say. So the if I ask the question that what is the displacement of the particle at 2 seconds at t equals to 2, then the answer to that question is at t equals to 2, displacement is with reference to the choice of coordinates. So the displacement, that is the particle has displaced from the origin by an amount equals to minus 1, and here x equals to minus 1 has to be categorically mentioned because x equals to plus 1 is somewhere here. So here the answer is the position of the particle at x equals to 2, at t equals to 2, particle at t equals to 2 is x equals to minus 1. The position of the particle at t equals to 0 is x equals to 0. Therefore, displacement of the particle from t equals to 0 to t equals to 2 is x equals to minus 1. The displacement is a vector like quantity. In this case, when we are still limiting ourselves to just one dimensional problem, you may feel that this is a scalar, but this is not so because this is having a negative sign. Whereas in the consideration of displacement distances, all distances are essentially positive numbers because they represent magnitude of displacement. So I hope that clarifies KSRCT's question. KSRCT, please leave a comment if you think it is clarified. Even otherwise, you may leave a comment. Okay, I don't think there is anyone else who is looking to ask any questions regarding the specific problem. Okay, KSRCT's question about what is the difference between average velocity and instantaneous velocity, I will take that in due course. But let me return to the CAM problem. So as I said, let's try to understand whether we can do this problem. PSGCT has asked me this question: what is a CAM follower? I can't approach this problem without knowing how the knife edge moves when the elliptic disc moves. So could you please explain? Okay, I think I will do this because I feel that we should be in a position to solve this problem at this point. So all we have here is an elliptic cam. It's just an elliptic disc. Which is rotating about its center, and right at this point you have a very sharp knife which is constrained to move along this direction. So there is no way it can move in this direction. This is not allowed. It can only move in this direction. So I will actually wipe this off. Okay, so I hope this geometry is clear to you. The reason I am bringing forth this problem to you is that to improve your visualization of motion. Now let's say this is the configuration of the problem at t equals to 0. Now as I have said, this body is tending to rotate anticlockwise as is indicated. So let us try and imagine what happens to this picture an instant later. An infinitesimal time later. So obviously the elliptic cam shape is not going to change. The elliptic cam shape being a rigid body, it's going to remain as it is. But as opposed to a circular cam, it will now rotate and take a form which is of this kind. So here the ellipse has rotated between these two pictures. The ellipse has rotated. Okay, so if the major axis was here at time t equals to 0, and I can draw that with a different color just to make things clear. So I can, so this is the position of the major axis at time t equals to 0. At a later time delta t, the major axis is here. Okay, so this is omega times delta t, right? I hope this is clear to everyone. Yeah, PhD City, tell me what you want to know about this cam problem.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, good morning.
Well, my question is, when the elliptic disc moves, how does the knife edge move up and down?
Yeah, I'll tell you. But have you understood this fact that the elliptic disc will keep rotating and therefore the configuration will change as is shown between the solid line and the dotted line?
Yeah, I understood that.
Okay, be with me. I'll tell you. Yeah. So let me continue with my analysis. So at time t equals to 0, elliptic, see, the knife edge has got to always remain in contact with the elliptic cam, right? And it is forced to remain in contact along this line. It cannot be in contact with an elliptic point leaving this line, right? Now note, between the solid line and the dotted line, this part has actually moved up, is actually lying horizontal. Now since this cam is rotating in an anticlockwise fashion as is indicated, at a later time, let's call this time capital T. So at a time small t equals to capital T, where capital T is large enough time, it will so happen that this major axis would have now rotated by 90 degree and taken this position, and the minor axis in turn would have rotated and taken this position, and therefore the elliptic cam would now look like this, even if you forget the follower, right? So therefore now if you bring in the follower, the follower is always supposed to be in the point of contact of the cam along this line. The line cannot change because the follower is forced to be along this guide. So whichever point it finds on the cam, the knife edge will go there. So at time t equals to 0, the knife edge will be, at time t equals to 0, this is the knife edge. Oh, sorry, it will come up to this point. The knife edge point is this, and at time t equals to delta t, at time t equals to capital T, I'm sorry, at time t equals to capital T, the knife edge will be here. So I have to draw a figure right here. So this is the knife edge position at small t equals to capital T. So definitely between small t and capital T, the knife edge has moved by this much. We have to find this distance, that's okay, but I hope this visualization makes it clear to you without an animation that the follower will in fact be moving in time, okay, because the elliptic cam is rotating and the knife edge is constrained to be always on the point of contact of this elliptic cam along this axis. Therefore, as the cam moves, the distance from the rotation to this point of contact will change, and therefore it will keep moving in a rectilinear motion. I am open to interactions at this point. I expect, please clarify, please put up your hand or invite me for an interaction if you think that this explanation is still not adequate and you still don't visualize why the follower should move up and down. PSGCT and others who has asked me that why should the follower move up and down, I hope you get yourself clarified through this intuitive explanation that the follower should move up and down. The remaining task is actually to find the mathematical expression of the follower motion and also to make a plot of it. I'll stop myself for an interaction. Let us see what have you people got to say. Okay, I'll do this part once again on the board. So at time t equals to 0, we have a cam something like this. So this is the configuration of the elliptic cam at t equals to 0, right? Now at a later time, this is the major axis of it, this is the minor axis of it. At a later time, you can expect this cam is going to turn a little bit. So that drawing I'll make again. So the major axis is going to turn in this fashion and the minor axis is going to turn in this fashion, and the cam will occupy a position something like this. I could draw this with a different color. Okay, so this is the configuration of the cam at some infinitesimal time ahead in the future. Okay, I hope this should be clear to you. And therefore, at time t equals to 0, the knife edge would be here. So this is the location of the edge. Since the knife edge is always constrained to be on within this guide, at a later instant of time, the knife edge would be here. Okay. So therefore, if I look at the motion of the knife edge between these two times, the knife edge has actually traveled by this distance. Right. So within delta t, the knife edge has traveled, and it will keep traveling at every instant of time. But the good thing about this motion is that it is unidirectional. The position, the velocity, the acceleration, all are unidirectional. Okay. So I hope things have been clarified as I am seeing in this chat. No, VC is asking me, you say about whether the disc is moving eccentrically. To keep matters simple, I have taken the disc is mounted exactly at its center. There is no eccentricity. Okay, that the shaft is rotating exactly at the center of the ellipse. You could consider the shaft to be moving at a point other than the center of the ellipse, in which case things will become a little more complicated. But to be simplistic, I said that the shaft is mounted exactly at the center, and therefore there is no eccentricity issue here. Yeah, go ahead, please. Any other questions? PCTN, you are asking me if the displacement is calculated only by position or anything else. Displacement is just position from the origin, And my suggestion to you is to choose the origin at the point of mounting. VC is asking me follower is going as SHM, but that's a derivation. I don't think at this point we need to spell out that answer. Please don't, my advice to VC, please don't recollect any formulas and have a mindset that it will have to be a simple harmonic motion or multiple harmonic motion. We'll see as it goes along whether it's, if it's simple harmonic, so be it. If it is not simple harmonic, so be it. We are not worried about the exact answer. We will derive the answer, and I intend to show you the derivation of this answer even for this complicated problem is actually not tough. VC, you seem to be asking me, is it following or not, sir? Yes, it is following. I mean, always the follower is at the point of contact with the elliptic cam. Therefore, it's following. I think most of you are jumping the horse. At this point, let's not, this is in response to the question asked from TPC, when the follower is asking me something about changing in velocity and so on and so forth. Let's not worry too much about the velocity. Let's first find out x against time. If x against time is known, whatever be the velocity, we will accept it. My question to you at this point, and let us think about only this question, is how to derive a functional relationship of x, which is the distance of the follower or the position of the follower from the origin to the current position of the knife edge. Okay, so let me do this problem for you. Anything else in my notebook, and hopefully this should be visible to you now without any technical glitches. Okay, so let's solve this problem. Fine. So as I said, this is the elliptic cam. I'm drawing on my tablet. I hope this is visible to all the users. In case it is not, please leave a message in the chat and my support staff will do the necessary actions. So this is the point that we are interested in. So what we wish to find out is what is the position of this point with reference to an origin. So what we'll immediately do is we'll take a coordinate system, which is x here, and just because this cam is two-dimensional, we'll put a y on this side. We are actually interested in the x motion, we are not interested in the y motion. Now at a later time, as I said, the cam will be in contact with the follower will be in contact with this point of the cam. At an even later time, it will be in contact with this point in of the cam and so on. So what I basically need to do is to find an expression for this radius of for this distance. So this is the point which will be in contact. So I'll call this A. So A is the point on the cam. On the cam, which will be in contact with the follower at a later time. Call this T. Okay, so therefore, what would be x at a later time? At a later time, this dotted line will come here. I'll change my color again to indicate what's happening at a later time. So at a later time, this line itself will rotate and come here. And therefore, the knife edge, which is supposed to be just at the point of contact A. So this point A would have come here, and the point of contact will be the position of the knife edge, right? So all that you have to do is to find the distance from the center of your elliptic cam to the point A. So x of t is basically the distance of the point of contact A from the origin of your coordinate system, which I'll call it as O. So this is O, right? So So I have to only find this distance. This distance is what is going to change with time as the cam rotates. So the distance from this mounting point, this is the mounting point O, to the point A, and we will keep considering different points along the periphery of the along the periphery here. So as we consider different points on this periphery, this radial distance will keep changing, and that radial distance is basically our x of t, because each of these radius vectors will in turn become the x of t's at later time, because the cam is rotating in this fashion. So if you recall now the parametric equation of the ellipse, which you would have studied again in your high school mathematics. So the parametric equation of the ellipse with this as x and that as y, I'm using a weird coordinate system here, if this is x and this is y, and this is my parameter, let's say theta, then x and this is A, or I put the major axis as A, so I will take this as B, and this is minus A. So therefore, x is B cos theta, and y is minus B sin theta. Right, so this is the parametric equation of ellipse. In terms of theta, so in terms of theta, which is indicated here, x is given by b cos theta and y is given by minus a sin theta, because this is A, right? And therefore, you will have R, which is square root of x square plus y square, to be square root of a square sine square theta plus b square cos square theta. So this is R. So at a later instant of time, so this R, you agree, will keep changing with time as theta changes with time. So theta will keep changing with time as theta is equals to omega t, right? Theta will keep changing with time, because as you move ahead in time, the point of contact will keep coming along this side. The cam itself is rotating in this fashion, which means the point of contact will keep coming on the periphery on this side, and therefore R of t will be given by this expression. So to write that again, R square t is square root or a square sine square theta t plus b square cos square theta t. And finally, if I make the substitution that theta is equals to omega t, I have R of t as square root of a square sine square omega t plus b square cos square omega t. So therefore, with time, this is the position of the follower with time with reference to this origin at O, is going to follow this functional relationship. So the position of follower with time is R of t, because as I said, the follower is simply going to be at a radial distance given by this R at a later time t. So once you have R of t, you can take the differentiation, you can take the differentiation once, in which case you will get the velocity. So now v of t is dr dt, and acceleration of t is d2r dt2. So you can now make all the plots, and you also have the functional form there with you. Okay, so I hope this example illuminates to you that it's actually not difficult to derive these expressions from a very fundamental viewpoint, which is what we have done. EPC is asking me when follower is contacting the cam major axis, is there any change in velocity? See, for TPC, I will tell you that don't try to visualize the velocity. Whatever velocity you are getting out of the expression, that is God given. So we are putting all our efforts to arrive at the expression of R of T. V of T is just derivative of R with respect to T. You take the derivative, see whatever happens will answer your question. So you don't need to visualize whether V is changing or T is not changing. This expression of V will tell you the story. So you yourself can answer this question if you work out the details of the problem. How to find the path traveled by the follower and the displacement of the follower in rectilinear direction? For GIT PGR, I will reiterate this expression of R of T. So I will write this again. So what I have derived is R of T is a square root of a square sine square omega T plus b square cos square omega T. This gives the position of the knife edge with time. With respect to time t. Okay. So what you have just asked me should be resolved through this. So what GIT JPR, you have asked me how to find the path traveled by the follower. This is the path traveled by the follower. So you are saying what is the path traveled? The path is nothing but the distance from the origin. So the origin being the point of mounting of the cam, the distance from this origin is changing with time in this fashion. So that is precisely the path of the follower. And whether you call this path or displacement, so this is the displacement of the follower in rectilinear direction, because I am expressing this only in one variable, which is R, right? So since this is the displacement along the direction of motion, which is just up and down, we have just argued intuitively the follower can move only in up and down direction. So therefore, definitely this is the rectilinear motion. So whether you call it path or whether you call it displacement, it is just the same. So therefore, this is the functional expression that we are looking for, and I hope you get this, that this is the solution as far as position is concerned. I will not do the differentiation of this expression with respect to time to give you velocities and acceleration. That I leave it as an exercise because it looks clumsy, but you can do it in a very smart way and take out the derivatives if you want to. We have done that, and if you want, we can post that solution in the course pack. But I would like you to independently solve this problem, and if required, you can take use of symbolic computation packages also to do the derivatives if you want. Okay, so at this stage, I think I'll go ahead now with the contents of the lecture. I hope this problem of cam follower mechanism, though it's a difficult one, is actually understood. Okay, now in the previous part of the course of the lecture, what we did study was how do we go from position to velocity to acceleration. Now we'll come the other way around. From acceleration we'll determine the velocity. So given the acceleration, velocity, just like acceleration was the derivative of velocity, given the acceleration, you can find velocity as a mere integral. So this is what this expression suggests, that the velocity is integral of acceleration. And when you do integration, you will remember that you need a constant of integration. So when you actually perform this integration, you will have a constant of integration. That constant of integration will be determined from some additional condition. Typically in such problems, as we will demonstrate through some calculation, that you will have an additional data that is given, which will allow you to determine that constant of integration. You may be, for example, given at some time what is the velocity that is given as a part of the problem, and using that additional information, the constant of integration will be determined. And therefore, the velocity difference between any two time instants will be the area of the curve. So, just a word of good advice that please account for positive and negative areas appropriately. So, what we are saying is that if this is the acceleration against time curve, then the area enclosed by this acceleration to time curve represents the difference in velocity between this time to that time. So, now that since this area is positive, by positive what I mean is that in this part of the graph all the acceleration values are positive. We will have a example also of the negative values, but here we see that all the values of acceleration are positive. So, therefore, this area is positive, and therefore, the difference in velocity at time 4 seconds and the difference in velocity at time 2 seconds. So, V4 minus V2, V at 4 seconds minus V at 2 seconds is a positive number, which means V at 4 seconds is actually more than V at 2 seconds. Now, you should take care that if this acceleration graph is negative, so had it been going in the other region, so I will draw that quickly in my tab. So, in case you had an acceleration graph which looks something like this, this is the time axis and this is the acceleration. So, let us say we have an acceleration graph which looks something like this. So, this part of the acceleration is positive, this part of the acceleration is negative. So, if you say this velocity is V0 and this velocity is, let us say, or let us call this V1, this is V1 and this is V2 and this is V0. Now, the fact that this area is positive, V1 minus V0 is basically A1, this area is A1, and V2 minus V1 is A2. This area in magnitude is A2, okay. But this is A1 and this is A2. So, this is positive, but this is negative, okay. A2 is a negative number, and because here in this entire duration the acceleration is negative. So, the fact that A1 is positive, this implies V1 is greater than V0. You all, this is fine. And here the fact that you have a negative area, that suggests that V2 is less than V1. So, this is my 0, which is what confused me in a moment ago. So, at time t equals to, the acceleration 0 is hit at this time. Before that all accelerations were positive, which means this area was positive. So, V1 minus V0 remains as a positive number here, whereas V2 minus V1 is actually a negative number because the acceleration in this duration is negative. So, acceleration during this period is negative. Okay. Whereas the acceleration during this period is positive, which is why this area is positive, which is why V1 will still be a positive, will be greater than V0. Okay. So, with this understanding of the graphical methods in terms of areas, situation will just be replicated when you go from velocity to displacement. Again, x of t will be given as an integral of velocity of dt, integral of velocity integrated with time, and again you will have a constant of integration popping out. So, again there is no way, other way to determine this constant of integration other than with some additional data given in the problem. As we will find out that usually there will be a data that will be hidden in the problem which will allow us to determine this constant of integration. So, this will be in the form that at some time you will exactly know what is the position. X of t at some time will be known, and therefore you will get x of t 0 will be x 0. So, therefore, that constant of integration will be determined, and as you know the integral is just the area of the curve. So, therefore, similar to what we derived in the case of acceleration, we will again have the area enclosed by the velocity graph to be denoting the difference in displacement or x. So again, we need to account for positive and negative areas appropriately, as I just argued. So herein I have an example where the velocity goes from negative to positive. So in this part of the curve, which is shown in red, you are finding that the velocity is always negative, and therefore this area is negative. So from this point to this point, there is definitely a change in position, but that change in position is having a negative value, which means that this point is actually having an x value which is lesser than this point. The x value corresponding to this point in time, or the displacement at this point in time, is lesser than the displacement at this point. Remember, displacement is always with respect to some origin. So the position of the point in terms of this x coordinate value will turn out to be lesser than the position at time t equals to 1. It is the other way around. If you look at this part of the time, in this part of the time velocity is positive, which means this area is positive, which means the x value at 3.5, let's say, is actually more than the x value at 2. So x value at 3.5 minus x value at 2 will exactly be equal to the area of this blue shaded region. Similarly, x value at 2 minus x value at 1 will be the area of the red region, but you have to put a negative sign associated with it just to keep track of the fact that this area was negative. And when you in fact do that negative, take that negative sign into account, you will be able to argue this, that x2 is actually lesser than x1. Okay. So with that, we will now turn to some problems, but before doing those problems, we will make a simplification. Till now we were saying that accelerations could be perfectly arbitrary functions in time. Now we will specialize, and we will say that let us specialize this to a case where accelerations are not even functions of time, they are in fact just constants in time. So a very important case of practical application arises in the case of motion due to gravity. So in such cases, as we know, acceleration due to gravity for most practical cases will be treated as constant, but we have an example to show you that even that can change with time and space. So we'll come to that example in due course. At present, let us try and understand when what kind of motion can be predicted when the acceleration with respect to time is actually a constant and is given by some number, we call that a. So if you do this integration, what we mean to say is that you will recall that v of t is integral a dt. Now that we have said a t is constant, we can pull this a out of the integration sign and say that a is in a integral dt. So therefore, v as a function of time is a t plus an integration constant c. Obviously, this integration constant has to be determined through this problem. So if at t equals to 0, v 0 is known to be u, then it will turn out that this v 0 is a times 0 plus c, which means v 0 is u, which means u is c. So therefore, this integration will lead us to the following result, that vt is equals to at plus u. This is a result which definitely you have seen in your high school physics also, but I hope there is absolutely no need for you to mark this up. And in fact, what I will challenge you with is that you should try and derive this similar sort of relation even if acceleration is not constant. So this relation, remember, is derived only under the special case that acceleration is constant. But if you proceed from first principles, you should not have much trouble in deriving similar relationship or solving similar problems wherein acceleration is not constant. And I have a non-trivial example in such of such case in my slides coming up in due course. So this is the velocity against time. Now, once the velocity has been determined in this fashion, so this c1 is basically the u that I wrote in the tablet a moment ago. Now, if this expression is used in the integral, what we get to see is that xt is integral at plus c1 dt. So if you integrate this out, you will get at square by 2 c1t and c2. So c2 is the constant of integration which arises from this process. So now displacement is a function of time, which is in this form. It has a quadratic, a squared term in terms of t square. It has a linear term in terms of t and an arbitrary constant. Again, this arbitrary constant should be determined if at time t equals to 0, you exactly know where the position is. And that is where we will try to be smart with our coordinate system. We will choose a coordinate system such that at time t equals to 0, mostly we will have x is equals to 0, and that will result in the constant being equal to 0. So with this, as I said, the constants of integration will be determined from some additional information that is given in the problem. So just before we proceed to the actual problems in the next half an hour or so, another problem of interest is that how do you relate the accelerations and velocity. So remember, both these relationships are about velocity and acceleration, and acceleration and space, and they involve time. So if you wish to have a relationship which does not have anything to do with time, this is how you can do it. We know from definition that v times dt, so velocity covered in a delta increment of time, should give you the delta increment in position x. Similarly, acceleration times dt should give you the increment in velocity. So this means accelerations time, instead of dt, I can write this dt to be dx by v. So again, I'll do this calculation for in the tab. So we know v times dt is dx, and we also know a times dt is dv. So therefore, a times, instead of dt here, we could write this as dx by v, right? So a times dt, instead of dt, what we will do is we will write this as a times dx by v is equals to dv, and that would give us a times dx is equals to v dv. The integration for this is easy as long as we are dealing with acceleration being constant. So if acceleration is constant, then you can actually integrate a integral dx is equals to integral v dv. So that would mean ax is equals to v square by 2 plus an integration constant. Again, you can derive this integration constant from some known initial conditions. And if you say that at x equals to 0, v is u, then you get to see ax is equals to v square by 2 a times, I think I am running out of space in my tablet, but that's because I'm not very conversant in using the tablet. So what we have got is ax equals to v square by 2 plus c. So at x equals to 0, we have v equals to 0, v equals to u given. So therefore, if we plug this condition in, what we get is a times 0 is equals to u square by 2 plus c, and that implies 0 is equals to c plus u square by 2, and that implies c is equals to minus u square by 2. So therefore, at the end of the day, what we have is ax is equals to v square by 2. Instead of c, I can put minus u square by 2. So this is again a formula that you will probably recall that you have encountered even in your high school physics, but we have again derived that from first principles, and hopefully we understand this derivation so very well that we actually never need to memorize this formula. So that is something that I have been emphasizing. Please don't memorize any formulas or try to map the problem to something that you have done in your previous course or something like that. Treat each problem in its own merit. I don't think dynamics is that difficult that you cannot do so. In fact, grow this habit of treating each problem at its own merit, treat each problem from its fundamental principles, and then you should be very conceptually clear and someone who will have a very unshakable kind of a knowledge. Okay, with that, we'll move on to some problems. Yes. So here I have one example of motion under gravity. So here is a nice story that we have framed. So there was a tourist who was taking photos at the top of the tower. Suddenly his camera slipped. The only thing that he has found out is that the camera took 5 seconds to fall onto the ground. So the question is, what is the height of the tower? Please don't try to do this from and destroy your camera in the process, but we can try to do this problem. So let's turn to our OneNote and try and do this problem quickly. This is a simple problem, but hopefully we'll have more complicated ones lined up for you. Okay, so at this point, so this is a tower. So at time t equals to 0, something seems to be falling from this point, and obviously it is going to fall in the downward direction. So I am choosing, as I said, a smart choice of coordinate system mostly is to choose x equals to 0 and t equals to, at t equals to 0, to be x equals to 0. So I will choose x equals to my origin right at the top of the tower from where the tourist has thrown his camera. So I already have this condition now with me that at time t equals to 0, x equals to 0 by choice of coordinate system. There is nothing wrong if you choose a coordinate system which is somewhere else, but as I will show you, this calculation is much simpler. Okay, so now the direction of acceleration due to gravity is g, which is in the direction of my axis. So the acceleration in the direction of my coordinate system is positive g. This is not going to be negative. So what I have is I need to solve for d2x dt2 equals to positive g to find its motion. So immediately I can integrate first. If I integrate this one time, I get dx by dt, which I know to be velocity of with respect to time, gt plus c, sorry, g into t, not a function of t, gt plus constant. Now as the camera is just dropped at time t equals to 0 without any velocity, so at time t equals to 0, v0 is 0. The tourist did not throw the camera in that direction, it just slipped from his hand. Since it slipped from its hand, so the velocity at that initial point of time is 0. So that tells me that c equals to 0 in the above expression. So therefore, what I have found out by now is velocity as a function of time would be simply g times t, and this we know is dx dt. And if I integrate this again, we get x equals to gt square by 2 plus constant of integration. Again, we know that at t equals to 0, we have x equals to 0. So at t equals to 0, we have x equals to 0. This is x of t. So therefore, this implies that the constant of integration is again 0. Right? And therefore, x against t is gt square by 2, and v against t is gt. These are the two expressions. Now let us see, we were asked to find out what is the height of the tower and what is the velocity just before impact. It took 5 seconds for the camera to fall. So we know the duration of time of fall of this object. So if we plug in t equals to 5 seconds here, if we plug in t equals to 5 seconds here, we should be able to get what is the x value at t equals to 5 seconds, right? Because x of t is now found out as gt square by 2. Since it has taken 5 seconds, we know that this is 10 into 5 into 5 divided by 2, which means it is 125 meter. I have taken g to be 10 meters per second squared just for simplicity in calculation. Okay, so x of t is basically the distance that this object has traveled within the duration of 5 seconds, because the tourist has confirmed to us that it has taken exactly 5 seconds for the camera to reach the ground. In this 5 second, our formula says that it has traveled only gt square by 2, and therefore when we work out this formula, it comes out as 125 meters. And also what was asked is, what is the velocity at the point of impact? The velocity at the point of impact would be g times t, which is 10 times 5, which is 50 meter per second. This velocity of impact is important, because if the velocity of impact is too high, the camera would crash. So none the same, from the formula we are very that we have derived for this particular problem, there is nothing that we have recalled from memory. We have derived, treated this problem on its merit, and derived from first principles what is the x as a function of time, what is the v as a function of time, and thereby we are able to see that we are actually able to solve the problem. I will do this problem in a little different method, because I had sort of emphasized yesterday that there is nothing sacred about the choice of coordinate system. As I made a remark that there is nothing wrong, so if this is my tower, there is nothing wrong if I choose my coordinate system at the ground. So I can say this is my x equals to 0. There is absolutely nothing wrong with this choice. But as I will show you, just that the calculation becomes a little more cumbersome. It is not that it cannot be done, but it just becomes a little more cumbersome. One thing which you have to note, that the acceleration due to gravity does not change due to your choice of coordinate system. The acceleration due to gravity is the effect of Earth, which is acting on each and every body, including me and you. That obviously does not change with your choice of coordinate system between me and you. So g always will be downwards, whether you choose coordinate system upwards or coordinate system downwards. But now if you realize what we have in this problem as opposed to the previous problem, in the previous problem the direction of our coordinate and the direction of g is same, which is why a equals to g. Whereas in this way of manner of solution, the direction of our coordinate system is opposite to the direction of g, and that is why we should put a equals to minus g. Okay. So again, the situation that we will like to solve for is d2x dt2 is equals to minus g, where g is 10 meter per second square as usual, right. And this time also the conditions will vary, because at time t equals to 0, it is being left from this point, which is an unknown. So at time t equals to 0, the position of x, x0 I will call it, is an unknown, which is the length of the tower. This is not yet known. Okay, we have to determine this, right. But velocity fortunately is still 0. This is at time t equals to 0, the velocity of release is just 0. So this term does not get affected. So again we can do the integration of this equation. So if we do the integration once, what we get is the following: dx by dt is minus gt plus c. So this is v of t. So v of 0 therefore is c, and since the condition is already given that v of 0 is 0, we must have c to be equal to 0. So this time our expression of velocity is minus gt. We should not be too worried, because last time it was plus gt. Last time if you see, the velocity was plus gt, I hope. Where was the result? Yeah, the velocity expression was determined here, vt as equal to gt. Even here it was determined. So here it is turning out to be minus, but that is quite natural, because our direction of coordinate system has reversed between these two problems. And now if you look to solve for x of t is minus gt square by 2, and again you will have another integration constant. I will call this c prime, just to distinguish between c and c prime. C is 0, but do you think c prime will be 0? A quick answer, in your chat, do you think C prime will be 0 in this case? How will you determine C prime? Please use the chat box to tell me whether C prime is 0 or not, whether it is 0 or non-zero. Just quickly type in the chat box whether you think C prime equals to 0 or C prime is not equals to 0. Okay, KNMU says it is 0. Okay, TKMKL thinks it is not 0. KNMU and LBSITW feel that it is 0. This is where I wanted to emphasize that please don't try to recollect any formula. Please try and derive it. It's not that difficult to derive whether it's 0 or non-zero, and I'll show that to you. We have already said at t equals to 0, x0 equals to L. So if I take t equals to 0 condition here, x0 is L minus gt square by 2 at t equals to 0 is 0, right? Plus c prime. So now, therefore, c prime is actually the length of the tower. So c prime is not equals to 0 is the right answer. This is the wrong answer. C prime is equal to L, which is definitely not equals to 0. So whether a certain integration constant will be 0 or non-zero, that definitely does depend on your choice of coordinate system. But whether you do it in this fashion or the other, both the answers are correct. So in this case, you will be getting the answer of x of t to be minus gt square by 2 plus L. This is also perfectly valid in this choice of coordinate system, right? There is nothing wrong with it. Okay. So with that, let us move with the next problem. We'll then have some question answer session at the end. So, okay. I guess this problem I will leave it as an exercise to you. So this time, what I have is a similar problem of motion under gravity, but this time at t equals to 0, the object is thrown upwards with a certain velocity 1 meter per second, and this time we know that the height of the tower is exactly 73 meter. So again, you should be able to do a similar problem solution as has been done in the previous case, and please do it with different choices of coordinate systems such that you get conversant with the ideas of different coordinate system, and then you should be very clear that both the methods give you the same answer. Okay. I will now give you a non-trivial example. As I said, there may be cases where these are the usual kinds of problem that you will find in any engineering mechanics book, the one which is dealing with constant acceleration. But just to show you the generalization of the approach, there is a generalization, there is life beyond constant acceleration. So let us consider this case of a satellite coming back, re-entering the Earth. So this launch vehicle, which is now at considerable distance from the Earth's surface, is to come back towards the Earth. But now, as you know, the acceleration due to gravity will change with position. The acceleration due to gravity in this case, as opposed to a camera falling from the tower, where you have taken the acceleration due to gravity, is constant. Here you cannot assume the acceleration due to gravity is constant. The acceleration due to gravity is going to change for this satellite as it is re-entering the Earth's atmosphere. It will be kilometers beyond the Earth's surface, maybe 100 odd kilometers beyond the Earth's surface, wherein the acceleration due to gravity is definitely different from the acceleration due to gravity felt at the Earth's surface. So if you have to do the kinematics for this launch vehicle as it returns back to the Earth's atmosphere, you have to consider that at a radial distance r from the center of the Earth, the acceleration due to gravity in its magnitude is going to be given by gm by r square. The magnitude of acceleration due to gravity is gm by r square. I repeat that word magnitude. The exact sign of it will be decided again by the coordinate system that you use. So now you see that you have an acceleration due to gravity in this problem, which is depending on position, which is not constant. But fortunately, again, you can write the same equation. The equation does not change. So again, in this problem, what you are trying to solve is d2r dt2 is equal to some acceleration which now depends on r. Okay, it is no longer a constant. Let us see what this equation will turn out to be. So this is the surface of the earth. The surface, the earth itself has a radius capital R, and as is given by this formula, at any location which is small r, given by I should have drawn this in a different. So this is the radius of the earth, and this is the location of the satellite from the center of the earth, right? So for us, the position variable is this r. So it is the origin of it is selected from the center of earth. Again, you should convince yourself that that is possibly the choice of coordinate which will enable you to do simplistic calculations. So what we are looking to find is what is the acceleration due to gravity with this choice of coordinate system. We already know the acceleration due to gravity should be in the direction of the center of earth. It should pull objects towards the earth rather than away from it. But this direction of g, as is indicated, is in opposition to the choice of coordinate system that we have chosen. So this g is actually going to be negative for the choice of coordinate system that we have at hand. Right? And we have already come to the formula where the acceleration due to gravity in its magnitude is given by capital Gm by r square, where capital G is universal gravitational constant, the value of which can be found from any book. Constant, and small r is distance from the center of the earth. And capital M is the mass of the earth. Again, mass of the earth is a constant and it can be found from data books. So the problem that we are now looking to solve is d2r dt2. We are trying to determine the position of this launch vehicle as it re-enters. So only thing that we know is that it is going to encounter a acceleration g, which itself is going to change. So acceleration d2r dt2 in this case is going to be g, but g is going to be negative. So gm by r square is the one which gives the magnitude. We should be careful in putting the negative sign to, once we know that we have chosen the coordinate system in this manner, we should put a negative sign on top of this gm by r square such that we get this relation minus gm by r square. So therefore, now we have to solve this differential equation d2r dt2 is minus gm by r square. So again, we are successful in determining what we call our differential equation of motion for the object of our interest. So this is the differential equation of motion for the object of interest. Equation of motion for the object of interest. Okay. Now, next question is, how do you solve this differential equation of motion? It turns out that this differential equation of motion, there may be some ways of analytical solution, but now that you are belonging to the Gen Y, generation Y as they call it, where you carry mobiles and apps and all this, you should not in fact try to attempt this solution analytically. You should use numerical integration schemes to solve the above ODE. Not every differential equations need to be solved in an analytical fashion. So this ODE can be solved using numerical integration, And this can be done in MATLAB, it cannot be done in Excel. It can be done in any symbolic computation package such as MATLAB and Mathematica and any scientific computation package. You should not try to do this in a symbolic computation. Do this in a numerical computation. You should be able to again arrive at similar plots of R against T or V against T, and acceleration against T is anyway gm by R square. So, what we have done for constant acceleration can be very easily extrapolated to even more complicated real life problems where the acceleration is actually not constant. It is just that at times we may encounter a differential equation which will be too difficult for us to solve in pen and paper, in which case we should obviously resort to our very good and faithful friend, that is a computer, and with a suitable software in our hands we should be able to implement such a solution of such differential equations. Some of you keep writing to us that you are looking for projects for your summer and winter vacations and whatnot. So, I leave this as a challenge to you now to implement this problem with the values of capital G and capital M that is known. Implement this differential equation solution in MATLAB and show how the position of this satellite change of this re-entry vehicle changes with time as it re-enters the Earth's atmosphere. You can do an analysis to show how this position plot will definitely depend upon the fact that you have used a functional expression for acceleration. The fact that you have used this expression and not g equals to 10. If someone thinks that in this problem g equals to 10 meter per second square is going to remain constant, you can plot his solution, and you can also plot the more accurate solution given by minus gm by r square, and then actually compare what is the difference between these two solutions and thereby prove that the solution which does not account for changing value of acceleration due to gravity is not capturing the true effect of effect for this problem. So, this as I again said is a more challenging problem. This is not something that you will do for your examination, obviously, whether it is GATE or whether it is your semester examination in your university, but this is something which I wanted to impart simply to motivate you towards this philosophy that you should look at problems in this generalistic sense. Don't look at formulas, because if you are able to look at problems in this generalistic sense, you should be able to approach the problems which are far more complicated than what is given in your book and what is presented in your curriculum. By no means I intend to say that your curriculum is not adequate. It is definitely adequate, but you should think beyond your curriculum is what my hope is. So, I will stop at this point and take a few questions on today's lecture material, but when we come back to the next day, that is on 9th, if I am not wrong, as we have scheduled it. So, we will do the last part of this kinematics, which includes curvilinear coordinates as well as projectile motion. Projectile motion definitely constitutes an important aspect in kinematics. We will do that in sufficient length, but hopefully I will be able to convince you that projectile motion, despite people getting scared of it, is just two rectilinear motions superimposed. Some of you, if you have looked through the presentation slides which has already been uploaded in the course pack, I wish to convey to you this idea that projectile motion is no more complicated than two rectilinear motion. So, if you understand how to solve a rectilinear motion in x direction, a projectile motion will simply be a rectilinear motion in x direction as well as a rectilinear motion in y direction taken together. So, that is the approach that we will have towards projectile motion, and to my mind it should not be a too complicated stuff. And then in the remaining part we will spend some time on curvilinear coordinates. So, that is the agenda for the next day. I will stop here since there is just 5 minutes time. I will take a few questions if you have any. Any questions by anyone? Yeah, CITCMB, please go ahead with your interaction.
Good afternoon. Yes. I have a question.
Yeah.
You said this variation of gravity,
yeah,
above the surface of the earth is d squared r by dt squared, this is minus gm by r squared.
Right.
Can you explain in a similar fashion how is it going to vary when you go down inside the earth crust?
See, my purpose is not to talk about how gravity differs over the surface of the earth or below the surface of the earth. That formula holds good for any r. I mean, the direct answer to your question is that gm by r square is the formula which holds for any r supposedly. But I just wanted to present an example which is more complicated than the usual example of acceleration remaining constant. So I have just chosen this as an example where I am actually able to demonstrate how to proceed in case acceleration is not constant.
So it was just an example.
Yes, I don't intend to take a physics class to demonstrate how gravity changes actually from the depth of the earth to the outer atmosphere. This is a kinematics class, and I intend to take this as an example, and it is also linked with our space applications, engineering applications, to demonstrate that there are engineering problems wherein acceleration is not constant. And possibly the student should appreciate, firstly, there are engineering applications where acceleration is not constant, and there is a way to deal with such problems, at if not in pen and paper, at least in a computer. But we know what is the equation we are looking to solve. If we think that this equation is too difficult to solve on pen and paper, we go to the computer and get it solved. That's how.
Thank you. Anyway, thank you.
Can you, VCV Vasavi is asking, can you give example where constant acceleration presents practically? Yes, if I drop any object in the surface of the earth within, you know, without going to outer space or anything like that, for all practical purposes, even in the Qutub Minar problem that we did, as the camera was falling from the top of the tower, we actually took g is constant, because in comparison to the radius of the earth, the height of the Qutub Minar is negligible. So within that small span of travel of the height of the Qutub Minar, within this distance, obviously acceleration due to gravity does not remain, obviously the acceleration due to gravity, ideally speaking, does change, but within this span of time, it is very minimal change. So we ignore that change. So any projectile motion, any object that you are throwing within the surface of the earth, unless it is going to the outer atmosphere, in all cases acceleration due to gravity is constant. Again, to repeat myself, the actual formula of acceleration due to gravity tell you it is never constant, but for engineering applications, you are looking at distances which are far smaller than the radius of the earth. And in such cases, if the distance that you are interested in is far smaller than the radius of the earth, that gm by r square formula is actually giving the value which is gm by r capital R square, where capital R is the radius of the earth. So you tend to ignore whether it is capital R or capital R plus some delta. So that some delta is very, very small, therefore ignore. That is about the question from VCE. GITGPR wants to ask me how to find the path traced by the follower, and that was the previous question. Okay, homework for the day would be that you please try and practice those example problems and the CAM problem, especially the second example of something being dropped from a tower. You try to practice this problem with different choices of coordinate systems, and please convince yourself that with each different choice of coordinate system, you are getting the same result and all the results make sense. So it is not possibly enough to solve a problem in one particular way. As I said, you should solve fewer problems, but you should solve the problems in a complete and holistic fashion. So one exercise that you should do to gain proficiency is to practice problems with different coordinate systems and ensure that in all these choices of coordinate system, you are eventually getting the same answers and it makes sense, modulo sine and whatever which can be expressed. Okay, PhDCT is telling me how to model acceleration and velocity function when the coordinate system is set of non-inertial frame. PhDCT, I think you are asking a question which is possibly not in the purview of this course. See, the difference between inertial and non-inertial frame is in the dynamics, it is not in the kinematics. In the kinematics, there is absolutely no context in which inertial frame and non-inertial frame arises. It is in an inertial frame, you have the Newton's formula, force equals to mass times acceleration. Whereas in a non-inertial frame, you have force equals to mass times acceleration minus pseudo force. Okay? So the link between force and acceleration, which is the part of kinetics, is what changes between an inertial and non-inertial frame. The inertial and non-inertial frame is absolutely equivalent as far as kinematics is concerned. In kinematics, we have absolutely nothing to say. Please note, in all these examples, we have never considered any inertial properties of our object. I did not tell you what is the mass of the cam. I did not tell you what is the mass of the camera which was falling. I did not tell you what is the mass of the stone which is throwing out. That is obvious, because to do the kinematics, you don't need to know any inertial properties. Similarly, to do kinematics, you don't need to specify whether it is inertial frame or non-inertial frame. Every frame is equivalent and you don't need to bother about this. But at the time of dynamics, when you are relating the acceleration to the forces, only then it will become important whether it's inertial or non-inertial. If you know it's an inertial frame, then only you can apply F equals to ma. If you know it is not an inertial frame, it's a non-inertial frame, you cannot apply F equals to ma. You have to account for an additional pseudo force, which I hope you will get to see when you come to dynamics in your college. TPC is asking whether GM by R square formula considers air resistance. No, it does not consider air resistance. GM by R square formula is just a formula to demonstrate how do you do the kinematics in case the acceleration is not constant. Air resistance is not considered, and usually in that kind of problem, you should not consider air resistance also, because that formula picks up the kinematics in outer space where there is no air. So therefore, I would still outer space where there is no air. So therefore, I believe that the formula is GM by R square appropriately captures the application in mind, which is that of a space vehicle re-entering the Earth atmosphere, wherein since we are considering outer atmosphere, the effect of air resistance will be minimal till it comes very close to the Earth surface. So yeah. If you wish to modify that formula, you should account for the air resistance only in the last part of its motion, where the air resistance could play a major role. But when it is far away from the Earth's surface, air resistance will obviously not be there. Okay. Anything else? Okay. What is instant? Yeah. Thank you for that question, KSR City. You had asked me this earlier also. What is instantaneous acceleration and average acceleration? I'll do that. So, the acceleration at, which is dv by dt. So, this acceleration is a function of time, right? At each instant, this can be at each instant of time, at is determined. So this is actually qualified as instantaneous acceleration. So all the acceleration terms that I have been using thus far is instantaneous acceleration. In contrast, if you are given the v, the velocity at final time at t equals to 0 to be, let's say, u, and velocity at small t equals to some capital T is, let's say, call this u1 and this is u2, then you could say average acceleration is u2 minus u1 divided by t. The average acceleration is just the final value minus the initial value divided by the entire time of travel. So, this is like you are approximating the entire acceleration to be a single function. You are ignoring the fact that the acceleration could be changing in time. Obviously, if the acceleration is constant, instantaneous acceleration and average acceleration will give you the same result. But if the acceleration is actually changing with time, it will not give you the same result. There will be cases where instant acceleration and average acceleration is going to be different. But the average acceleration, I should call it as acceleration average. So the average acceleration will be given by the initial and the final values only. It will ignore whatever has happened in between this initial and final time instance. that you will be able to be convinced that it is just a mere approximation that you are taking, that you are just interested in the final time instance. I would not find this concept of average acceleration too useful, but since you asked me, this is the answer for it. I hope this clarifies your question. Please leave a remark if you feel so. Yeah, you have already said so. Thank you. Have a good day ahead.